Good morning, I'm Georgetta. Welcome to worship.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our Selkirk United Church online service for May 16th, 2021. I'm glad you've joined us today. I am Reverend Cole, and it is the seventh Sunday of the Easter season, also the final Sunday in this Easter season in which we celebrate resurrection and new life. Next Sunday, we will be celebrating Pentecost Sunday, which is also known sometimes as the birthday of the Christian Church. At Selkirk United Church, we are called to live and celebrate our Christian faith as a diverse, inclusive, and welcoming community in an ever-changing world. We are proud to be an affirming church, and we also recognize that we worship on Treaty One land within the homeland of the Métis Nation. We begin our service this morning by lighting the Christ candle to remind us of the risen Christ, and by lighting the rainbow candle, symbolizing that all are welcome. Our first hymn this morning is from More Voices, 221, I Am Walking a Path of Peace. Let's sing together. Let us bow our heads for our prayer of approach. Let us pray. Eternal God, source of all life, we marvel at your great gift of resurrection love. Your sacred name is echoed throughout the universe along with the jubilant cry of the resurrected Christ. Your message of justice, forgiveness, and new life resounds in all spheres of life. May we mirror your grace. Be with us, we pray, O God, in our worship service this morning and in all of our days. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Announcements today. Our spring concert, Make a Joyful Noise, is today. And I hear it's lots of fun. So don't miss it. Those of you who are on our email list should have received an email with a link to the concert, and you'll be able to click on that link and watch anytime after, I think it's 2:30 this afternoon. Enjoy. Our SAC Religion online gathering group resumes this week. We'll meet on Tuesday at 1 p.m. on Zoom. Newcomers are always welcome. Just let me know so I can send you an invitation with the link. I understand that our Selkirk United Church Youth Group is having a food bank car rally Sunday, June 6th, 1 till 3 p.m. Please contact Chris by May 31st to support the youth and the food bank by contributing food or money. Financial gifts will receive a tax receipt. And I also understand that they have a commercial to pique our interest. So here it is.
Julianne, we're going for a car rally. Doing? Those are for the Selkirk Food Bank.
Oops, I forgot.
Oh no.
Join us June 6th for our Selkirk United Church car rally. Leave food or money on your doorstep. Contact Chris if you want to participate or for more information.
That was great. Thanks, youth group. In Sunday school news, today is actually the final Sunday school class until the fall. I want to thank everyone who helped with Sunday school this year. You all did a fantastic job providing online classes for the children and keeping everyone safe at home, but still learning about God. Thanks so much. We will have more to say about all of that coming up in a few weeks during our wind-up Sunday service. Okay, on to celebrations. Some birthdays to celebrate. Nancy Muller celebrated her birthday on May 11th. Happy birthday, Nancy. Glenn Hansen celebrated his birthday on May 10th. Happy birthday, Glenn. And Donna Culbertson is also celebrating a birthday this month. Happy birthday to Donna. And I think that's all I have for announcements today, seeing none others. If you have announcements to share with the congregation, please send them in and we will add them in for next Sunday. Okay, now for our children's time story. This is an important story for these times that we live in. We see a lot of bad things on the news, and if we're not careful, we might start believing that the world is a bad place and that most of the people in the world are bad people. But this book reminds us that the opposite is true. There are some bad things that happen, and there are some people who do bad things. But God has created a wonderful world and has planted the seed of goodness inside all of us. And most people try their best to be the good people God created them to be. The story is called Most People, and it's written by Michael Liana. Here it is.
Most People by Michael Liana, illustrated by Jennifer Morris. Most people love to smile. Most people love to laugh. Most people love to see other people smile and laugh, too. Most people are good people. Most people want to help when they see someone crying. Most people want to help when they see someone who is in trouble. Most people want to make other people, even strangers, feel good. Most people are very good people. Some people do bad things. They yell bad words. They lie and steal. They bully and hurt and destroy. But most people don't do those things. If you could line up all the people who want to be good and all the people who want to be bad, the good line would stretch from here to the tallest mountain. All the people in the bad line could crowd together in a dark and gloomy room. People who do bad things can change. There is a seed of goodness inside of them, waiting to sprout. Most people love the sunshine. Most people love the earth. Most people love watching things grow. A person who is frowning and mad or sad or mean is like a sour grape in a bunch of sweet grapes. That person would almost always rather be happy, smiling, and laughing. Everyone looks nicer when they smile and laugh. When you see something bad happening, you may soon see someone trying to help. The helper might be you. Someone is always there being good because being good is what most people do. Most people like to run and dance and play, or share stories with someone they know, or snuggle with someone they love. Most people like a kind word. Most people like thinking good thoughts about others. Most people smile when they see a baby. Most people glow when they hear or say, "I love you." Most people in the world know that most people are very good.
Dance with the Spirit early in the morning. Walk with the Spirit throughout the long day. Work and hope for the new life we're born in. Listen to the Spirit to show you the way. Dance with the Spirit early in the morning. Walk with the Spirit throughout the long day. Work and hope for the new life we're born in. Listen to the Spirit to show you the way.
In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together, the crowd numbered about 120 persons, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit, through David, foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share of this ministry." So, one of the men who had accompanied us during the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection. So they proposed two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who is also known as Justice, and Matthias. They prayed and then said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in his ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. After saying this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and declared, "Very truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." The disciples looked at one another, uncertain of whom he was speaking. One of his disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter, therefore, motioned to him to ask Jesus of whom he was speaking. So while reclining next to Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one whom I give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in this dish." So when he had dipped the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, son of Simon Iscariot. After he received the piece of bread, Satan entered into him. Jesus said to him, "Do quickly what you are going to do." Now, no one at the table knew why he had said this to him. Some thought that, because Judas had the common purse, Jesus was telling him, "Buy what we need for the festival, so that he should give something to the poor." So after receiving the piece of bread, he immediately went out, and it was night. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to the place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Jesus brought a detachment of soldiers together with the police from the chief priests and with the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you, I am him. So, if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me."
A week or two ago, our midweek discussion group somehow got around to the topic of Judas Iscariot. I don't remember that being the topic for the day, but we somehow got around to discussing that. We get around to discussing all sorts of things that aren't exactly on topic in that group. We had a pretty good conversation about Judas that day, his character, his choices, how he fit into the story of Jesus, all of that. And then today, the lectionary gave us the reading from the book of Acts that talks about choosing a successor for Judas, another apostle to replace him among the 12. So I thought I would take the opportunity to look at Judas a little more closely. And so I changed the gospel passage for today and chose instead the other two passages that we heard a moment ago from John's gospel, which are also about Judas and the last days of Jesus. I'll get back to Judas in a moment. The other thing I wanted to focus on today was the idea of choice. That passage from Acts is about choice, choosing between two different people to carry on the work of Jesus. Interesting that the other 11 apostles spent time in prayer before making their choice. That seems like an important lesson for all of us in helping us make the choices that we are called to make in our day-to-day lives. I wonder if we all spent some more time asking God to guide us in our choices, if maybe we'd end up making better choices. I'm sure we would. Another theme that is closely related to choice is destiny. The idea of destiny for me shows up in both of those readings from John's Gospel. I think it's very interesting to look back at the story of Judas and his choice, to look at whether or not he had a choice, and by extension, whether any of us really have choices. I want to spend some time on both of those themes today, the themes of choice and destiny. Let's start with the story of Judas. Judas has become the caricature of evil. The name has become synonymous with one who betrays a friend, who is deceitful and just plain evil. Judas is one of those names that was probably, once upon a time, quite a nice name, even a popular name. But a name that people don't generally choose for their children anymore. It's funny how one individual can ruin a perfectly good name, isn't it? You don't hear anyone introducing their family these days saying, "These are my three beautiful children, Judas, Jezebel, and Adolf." There might be a few of those around, but I don't think they're the most popular choices. But was Judas really and truly an evil man? Or did he just make the wrong decision, a bad choice? Or is there another option? There's always two sides to every story, isn't there? I attended a conference once in which we heard the story of the Good Samaritan from a number of different perspectives, including one from the point of view of the robber who attacked and beat the victim in the story and left him for dead on the side of the road. They had an actor playing the part of the robber and explaining things to the crowd from his point of view. And the way the robber described his circumstances and told his story, we almost started feeling sorry for him. It didn't make it okay that he had committed this crime, but it did make us think about the story in a different way. As for Judas, we may want to answer quickly that he was simply an evil man because of who he betrayed. If he had betrayed anyone else, maybe we wouldn't feel so strongly, but he betrayed Jesus. Before we set our minds too quickly, though, let's look back at something that Jesus himself said. Remember the passage from John's Gospel in which the woman was caught in adultery? The teachers of the law pointed out to Jesus that the law stated that she should be stoned to death. But Jesus said, "Whichever one of you has committed no sin, you may throw the first stone at her." Whoever is without sin may cast the first stone, right? He didn't say that she was innocent. In fact, after all the religious zealots had put down their big jagged rocks and wandered off grumbling, Jesus said to the woman, "Now go and sin no more." That story means that none of us can claim perfection. None of us can pick up a jagged stone and be ready to throw it at another. So we'd better be very careful about condemning those around us. Same message from Luke's gospel about taking the log out of our own eye before we try to take the speck out of our brother's eye. Those passages teach us plainly that Jesus didn't want people to sin, but if and when they did, they should be forgiven and given another chance. Judas has not been given another chance by historians or by Christians. Judas has been condemned for all time for his actions. So was Judas an evil man, more evil than the rest of us? Well, none of us accepted 30 pieces of silver to betray Jesus to the authorities. Some of us might have done it for 10. Besides, we have our own methods of betrayal. Jesus called his followers to carry on his work, to love and care for others, to spread the good news about the kingdom of God. Have we done that? Or have we betrayed not only Jesus, but our brothers and sisters who are suffering because we haven't cried out on their behalf? We haven't listened. We haven't been shaken out of our apathy or our busyness enough to hear Christ's call. Being a follower of Jesus is about making the connection between saying we are Christian and learning how to live it out in what we do. Taking seriously the role we play in making the world the place it is and the place it will become. It's easy for us to pass the buck and to try to explain away the violence and the hunger and the agony of the world as being the fault of only the really evil people. I think we all know that it's way more complicated than that, and that we all have a part to play. In his play, An Inspector Calls, J.B. Priestley portrays vividly how we are all guilty of betraying our fellow human beings, often without really thinking about how we are complicit in the social and societal systems around us. In the play, a police inspector calls upon a respectable middle-class family to ask some questions. A little girl, Eva Smith, has committed suicide. Does the man of the house, a respectable citizen, know anything of her? He does not recall the name, but after some questioning, recalls that he fired her from his factory 2 months previous because she wanted another half dollar a week. What does the daughter know of her? Nothing. Until shown the girl's photograph, then she realizes that this was the shop assistant about whom she had complained in a fit of bad temper just a week ago, and who had been dismissed in consequence. Each one around the prosperous merchant's table, his wife, his son, his prospective son-in-law, had helped to push Eva Smith into the darkness where she took her life. The unique thing about this play develops as it progresses, when the police inspector appears less like an officer of the law and more like God. And the judgment passes on all who thought themselves innocent. And they are shown that they, in subtle and rational ways, betrayed a fellow human being in a moment of great need. We are too quick to brand people as either good or evil. All of us make good decisions, and all of us make bad decisions. Judas was no different. Jesus would not have chosen him for a disciple if he had been a completely evil man with no good in him. Some scholars have wondered if Judas was trying not to betray Jesus, but to force his hand, to force him to be the kind of Messiah that many in Israel wanted and expected him to be, the kind of Messiah who would raise an army and fight the Romans and save his persecuted people by force. Those people think that probably what Judas was trying to do, to change Jesus from a servant leader to a mighty warrior before it was too late, was something that God actually gave him to do. Maybe. Others have said that Judas did God's will. The betrayal had to happen to fulfill God's plan. Despicable as it seems and reads to us as we read the gospel, Judas was willing to do it because he was just obeying God's will for him. Maybe. We will never really know the reasons behind Judas's actions, but it raises interesting questions about whether Judas really had a choice in what he was doing. Maybe it was destiny. Many people believe that everything in this life is destiny, that God has a master plan, that it is all pre-planned, and that it all somehow fits together and makes sense in the grand scheme of things. If that's the case, then Judas is certainly not to blame. He was just fulfilling his role, playing his part. It was Jesus' time to die, and Judas was chosen to be a part of that story, helping history unfold as it was meant to unfold. Maybe. I don't think so. Is it the will of God that some people live in poverty while others are multi-billionaires? Is it the will of God that a pandemic continues to spread around the globe, causing fear and suffering, loss of life and livelihood? Is it the will of God that scientists should find their highest pursuit in making weapons, while cries of hunger fill the air? Is it the will of God that children get abducted by predators in our cities or step on landmines in war-torn countries? No, says Jesus. Jesus said, "It is not the will of my Father in heaven that one of these little ones should perish." Jesus also said, "Thy will be done," when he prayed. But that doesn't mean that everything that happens is God's will. "Thy will be done" is prayed with the hope that God will tell us what God's will is, and that we will be wise enough to listen and to follow, that our actions may be more than just our own determinations, but that they may be guided by God. So if it isn't God's will that evil happens, then predestiny doesn't make sense. Looking at it another way, if everything was predestined, nothing would matter. We would have no real choices to make. They would be made for us. No sense agonizing over a decision. It's already planned. No sense giving advice to our children, no sense trying to help others, no sense being careful, because everything is pre-planned and we have no control, no chance of making a difference. The only thing that does make sense is that we do have choice. And in many ways, we create our own destiny through how we choose to live. God allows us to make choices, whether they be right or wrong. Judas did that. We do that. And our destiny is not written in the stars or anywhere else. Our destiny is wrapped up in whether we choose wisely, who we listen to, whether we invite God to guide us and Christ to journey with us. I found these words about destiny from an anonymous author. It goes like this. Watch your thoughts. They become words. Watch your words. They become actions. Watch your actions. They become habits. Watch your habits. They become character. Watch your character. It becomes your destiny. Our destiny is not handed to us by God, but God can certainly play a vital role in shaping it if we let God into our lives in a significant way. God has created all of us to be free, to journey where we will, to make our own choices in life. It is completely up to us to what extent we welcome God and invite Jesus to be part of our journey. Friends, let's choose wisely. If we do, blessings will surely follow, not just for us, but for all who are affected by the choices we end up making. May God guide us all as we journey on. Amen.
He came singing love, and he lived singing love. He died singing love. He arose in silence for the love to make it our song. You and I be the singers. He came singing faith, and he lived singing faith. He died singing faith. He arose in silence for the faith to go on. We must make it our song. You and I the singers. He came singing hope, and he lived singing hope. He died singing hope. He arose in silence for the hope to go on. We must make it our song. You and I be the singers. Singing peace, and he lived singing peace. He died singing peace. He arose in silence for the peace to go on. We must make it our song. You and I be the singers.
Let's bow our heads for an offering prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and generous God, please accept these gifts that have been offered and will be offered, gifts of time and of talent and of treasure. We pray that all of us and all of these gifts may bring joy and health and hope to this community and beyond. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. And we continue with our prayers of the people. Let us pray. Loving God, we feel your Holy Spirit within us and within our church. Keep us energized by your presence so that we are not content with the status quo. Help us to keep your Spirit alive within us so that we may truly live as your people. While the day-to-day functioning of our church is important, it is not our reason for being. Help us to remember we are more. Help us not to be so distracted that we forget what is at the heart of our church, that we may live the life of Jesus in our world, spreading joy, spreading peace, spreading good news. Guide and support us as a missional church, spreading the good news of the gospel, living with the strength of your Holy Spirit and as disciples of Jesus. Gracious God, this morning we have special prayers for those we know and love who need your loving care and your good news this day. We pray for Jean, Kay, Len, Bobby, Jen, Diane, Lexi, and Tyson. Hear also our prayers for Richard, Lisa, Marquita, Helen, and Jeanette. Gracious God, we also have prayers this day for the people of Palestine and the people of Israel. We pray for peace, peace with justice. And we pray for all those who continue to suffer, those who grieve, those who live in fear in that part of the world and elsewhere where there is violence and war. God, hear all of our prayers, and in your love, answer. All of these things we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together with these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now our United Church Creed.
We are not alone.
We live in God's world.
We believe in God.
Who has created and is creating.
Who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh.
To reconcile and make new.
Who works in us and others by the Spirit.
We trust in God.
We trust in God.
We are called to be the church.
To celebrate God's presence.
To live with respect in creation.
To love and serve others.
To seek justice and resist evil.
To proclaim Jesus.
Crucified and risen.
Our judge and our hope.
In life, in death, in life beyond death.
God is with us.
We are not alone.
Thanks be to God.
Life that
Thank you all for sharing this time of worship with us. As we end our service, may we feel ourselves blessed, knowing that we are blessed by God. May we feel ourselves forgiven, knowing that we are forgiven. May we feel ourselves loved, knowing that we are loved. Now may we go to bless others, to forgive others, to love and to serve others in Jesus' name. And as we go, may the grace of Christ attend us, the love of God surround us, and the Holy Spirit keep us this day and forevermore. Amen.
Donna, and have a good week.